Coming up, a look at an important period in Black history, the explosion of creativity known as the Harlem Renaissance. We'll talk to several experts in the field and view works of art from an exhibit entitled The Turning Point. It features artists from the Renaissance years. Then, a visit with today's Pause for Pride, businesswoman Phyllis Mouton of Lafayette, the first Black woman to serve as president of the Lafayette Chamber of Commerce. We're continuing our salute to Black History Month on today's edition of Folks. Hello, everyone. I'm Sonya Masingale. Welcome to another edition of Folks. The Turning Point, the Harlem Renaissance, is the title of an art exhibit showing at the LSU Union Gallery in Baton Rouge. Part of the Aaron Douglas Collection from the Amistad Research Center in New Orleans, it contains paintings and sculptures of some of the great Black artists from the era known as the Harlem Renaissance. The time was the early 20th century, the place Harlem, New York City, and the arts and literature from that time comprises what is said to be the birth of ethnic expression among American Blacks. We're going to share with you some of the artwork from that exhibit, but first we'll discuss what the Harlem Renaissance was all about. The Harlem Renaissance or Revolution?
Dr. Huel Perkins, Assistant Vice Chancellor for Academic Affairs at LSU Baton Rouge, has a special affection for the Harlem Renaissance. He received a National Endowment for the Humanities grant to research the writers of that time.
A significant number of Black creative artists, Black intellectuals, Black writers came together at just a point in our history. And as this exhibit, which is being hung now at LSU, will indicate, it was a turning point. We headed in quite a different direction. Charles Johnson likes to feel that it was an altogether phenomenal period. They just happened to have been in Harlem. They happened to have come together. There was something that brought them together. And they had something to say. And there were a lot of forces and a lot of people and a lot of circumstances which were at work during this period, which would permit them to say what they had to say.
Although the Harlem Renaissance included visual artists, the major force behind the movement was the written word. The first all-Black art exhibit did not take place until 1928.
The period itself was a very brief one, really about 10 short years. Everybody is not in agreement as to exactly when it began, but that happens with all art movements. You can't say they began on January 1st, 1987 or what have you. Approximately between 1917 and 1929, and many times we just say the whole decade of the 20s is when it was at its height, at its peak, that those are the years which we like to refer to as the Harlem Renaissance. Why 1917? Only because a number of persons have identified the opening gun of the Harlem Renaissance as being shot by Claude McKay in a poem which he published called Harlem Dancer. It was a poem which again struck out in a new direction. It had some elements in it which had not been encountered before. You have to realize that during this period that there was this rejection of conservatism, that there was this embracing of ethnic and racial roots, that there was this heightened sense of manhood which was brought about by soldiers returning from World War I. And the whole idea was to find in our own culture those things which were important and celebrate those, and a withdrawal from the dominant culture. And as somebody says, a disassociation from the latent desire to whiteness.
The works on display in the Turning Point exhibit show clearly the movement from classical to ethnic expression. This is also evident in the poetry of that time.
Listen to this, it's called Harlem Dancer. Applauding youths laughed with young prostitutes and watched her perfect half-clothed body sway. Well, prostitutes may even be new for that time. Her voice was like the sound of blended flutes blown by black players upon a picnic day. She sang and danced on gracefully and calm, the light gauze hanging loose about her form. To me, she seemed a proudly swaying palm, grown lovelier for having passed through a storm. Passed through a storm. He's looking at this black woman and says she has been ridiculed. Upon her swarthy black neck, shirley curls, shiny curls fell profusely, and tossing coins in praise, the wine-flushed, bold-eyed boys, and even the girls, devoured her with their eager, passionate gaze. And this is the line, this little couplet here. But looking at her falsely smiling face, I knew herself was not in that strange place. So it's all there. In my talk the other night, I showed how this was a turning point. All the references were there. There's this reference to blackness, which was the rallying cry of the day. Incidentally, Black is Beautiful became very, very important there. Marcus Garvey began his Back to Africa movement, saying that we should, all blacks should leave the United States, go back to Africa. We should take Africa, develop it. And he started steamship line to take everybody back, raised money. He never did get everybody back, and he never did go to Africa himself. He was from Jamaica as well. But anyway, this emphasis upon blackness, this alienation from one's true culture, which needed to be reclaimed. She was not in that place. It was a false smile. And then there's a reference to the storm through which she passed, which is a metaphor for the treatment blacks have received in this country. Whereas the poet observed, she had grown lovelier for having passed through this storm. Then there's the title itself, Harlem, Harlem Dancer, a place of black culture, black life, black ideals, black creativity. The whole of the Renaissance may have taken its impetus from just such poem, just that opening gun. Now, there's another that I'd like to read, just a companion to that, by a lesser known figure, Warren Cooney, born in Washington, educated in Howard and Lincoln universities. But he wrote a nice little poem called No Images. Again, this is sort of celebrating blackness and saying what we have within our own in our own culture. Called, as I said, No Images. She does not know her beauty. She thinks her brown body has no glory. If she could dance naked under palm trees and see her image in the river, she would know. But there are no palm trees on the street, and dishwater gives back no images. Isn't it powerful? It's a very powerful statement.
Florence Borders, the archivist of the Amistad Research Center in New Orleans, is also a student of the Harlem Renaissance. In addition to the Aaron Douglas collection, which includes the works shown in the Turning Point exhibit, Amistad also houses many of the publications of Harlem Renaissance writers.
One of the best collections we have on the Harlem Renaissance is the Countee Cullen papers. The papers contain letters, books, I think programs, photographs, a number of items about Harlem Renaissance personalities. As you know, Countee Cullen was one of the leading poets of the Harlem Renaissance. And his first marriage was to the daughter of Dr. W.E.B. Du Bois. There are letters from Dr. Du Bois to Countee and to Yolanda after their marriage, when the marriage was in trouble. But basically, the collection for the period of the 20s is between Countee and other artists like Anna Bonton, Langston Hughes, James Weldon Johnson, and when the center acquired the manuscript collection and the personal papers of Countee Cullen, it also acquired his personal library, so that we have many, many, many first editions signed, inscribed with Countee Cullen's book plate. And this usually is considered by some people who are real collectors to be one of the thrills of handling the items that are here in the center that pertain to the Harlem Renaissance.
The visual artists and writers of the Renaissance were aware that they were in the middle of an important time in history. Most of them were acquainted and supported each other's artistic efforts.
Was there very much interaction between the visual artists and, say, the men of letters of that time?
Oh, yes, a great deal. They were very supportive of each other to the extent that they shared their financial resources. And one of the paintings that we have in that exhibit over there is of Countee Cullen, done by Huel Woodruff. Now, Huel Woodruff was in Europe at that time, and he had won a Harmon Foundation Award, but Countee Cullen was there on a Guggenheim. He had a little bit more money, and so he commissioned Huel to do a portrait of him. He was really helping to support him while he was in Paris.
People associated with the Harlem Renaissance were not always writers and painters. James Vanderzee documented the people and social and political events photographically. Ida Cullen, Countee Cullen's second wife, dedicated her life to the preservation of her husband's personal library. Because of this, not only publications and paintings of this time exist, but a legacy of personal information about the men and women of this era.
There are biographies written on some of these people. And because Ida Cullen devoted so much of her time after the death of Countee to traveling, reading his poetry, trying to see that his books did not remain out of print. And because she lectured a great deal about him, at least we get to know some of the things about him. Because some of this was so real to her, she could pick up a piece, pick up a letter, and relate some incident or something. For instance, when I was asking her about the letters to Art Nimmons, who was married to Ida Cullen's daughter. Okay, she could just go on and on about how Countee related to that young man, what a thrill it was for him to receive letters from this young man who was in the military and who was writing from the bases in Europe and so forth where he'd been stationed. Because the young man felt that he was covering some of the same ground that Countee as a young man had covered when he was on fellowships, Guggenheim fellowships, and when he was just traveling in general with his father or with other members of the Harlem Renaissance. Countee and the young Harlem Renaissance artists and personalities traveled extensively. They spent a lot of time in Europe, and they had probably a second home in Paris. Augustus Savage was there. Then James Weldon Johnson, they even had favorite hotels. When Countee and Yolanda married, they went and lived near Paris. They went to visit Henry O. Tanner, the great artist. I mean, they just had such a lively kind of contact and communication and such an extended travel arrangement that they added many dimensions to their works by the kind of exposures that they experienced in travel.
W.B. Du Bois had quite a bit to do with the movement. In fact, he may have inspired writing from a number of the poets and playwrights and novelists, because he believed that you should place it in writing. He and Booker T. Washington had a great debate, but he put his response, his rebuttal, in writing in The Souls of Black Folk, and published in 1903, but it had a lot to do with the written word by giving it some sort of permanence rather than oratory. He was a patron. Charles S. Johnson, who was the executive director of the National Urban League and also the editor of its magazine, which was called Opportunity, the NAACP's house organ was called The Crisis. And both of these were publishing outlets. But not only did Charles Johnson make it possible to publish in these magazines, Opportunity and some of the others, he also organized what was called Opportunity Dinners. And he would bring all of these budding young artists together, have them meet publishers, have them meet other poets and writers from other groups, just so that could be some sort of camaraderie, and they could grow and develop and find publishing outlets. The important thing for anybody who's writing is that he can find some place to publish.
The legacy of the Harlem Renaissance profoundly moves all who are exposed to it, even those who are exposed to the era later in life, such as Louisiana writer Ernest Gaines.
When I went to school in San Francisco, I went to Stanford, San Francisco State and Stanford, we just did not have books by blacks in these colleges and universities. So I really did not discover the black writers, including Ellison and Hughes and all the rest, until after I had gotten out of college. So they did not have any great influence on my work. I think by the time I started reading black writing, I had developed the style or whatever I had to say. But as I said earlier, I think the one book that would have had a great influence on me, if I had read it early, before I really read it in college or in high school, is the book Kane by Gene Toomer, which I think is probably one of our best, no probability about it, it's one of our best books.
Now we have moved away from it by, say, half a century, and we're able to get a retrospective view of the flowering of that period of these literary and visual artists, also of performing artists. I think that we are near enough for people to tell us about some of the activities and some of the personalities associated with it, but far enough to assess its value and to be inspired by it. I think many of the writers of the 70s were inspired by the writers of the 20s because they were able to get some role models.
If the Harlem Renaissance had not occurred, if there had been no W.B. Du Bois, no Claude McCade, no James Weldon Johnson, we would not have had the intellectual basis for a black studies program in the 60s and following. What they did was to leave us a body of material which could be researched, could be studied, could be critiqued, which could be used in these sorts of things. In other words, during that time, we were just really going back and discovering how prolific a writer W.E.B. Du Bois had been. You see what I'm saying? How much Langston Hughes had written, how much the Harlem Renaissance had produced in terms of literary output. That, to me, was the most important value of this period. Its importance is that it produced this work that was there when we needed it. Now, where are we in 1987? I think that there's been, obviously, and this period has inspired, there have been a large number of poets, of writers, who took their impetus from this period. That if they could, in fact, produce these kinds of works in the period in which they live, we are freer now, we have much more to draw upon, we're perhaps more intelligent. We can do more than was done then. I must say, and I don't know if I said this in my remarks, that the Harlem Renaissance ended with the stock market crash in 1929, when the bottom fell out of our economy. That was the end of the Harlem Renaissance. You see, because to be able to write, you've got to have food in your stomach. You've got to be devoid of having to be concerned about the bare necessities of life, such as food, clothing, shelter. You have to be free.
The Harlem Renaissance or Revolution. Through the works of literature and art that live on, we find that it was a time of both.
She does not know her beauty images.
This work and many others can be found at the Amistad Research Center in New Orleans. Now on to the next portion of our program. This week's Pause for Pride features Phyllis Mouton of Lafayette, who has the distinction of being not only the first black, but also the first female to serve as president of the Lafayette Chamber of Commerce in 1986. Now, Phyllis Mouton is truly a woman of the 80s. She is married, the mother of three, and a full-time partner at Circle M Supply, a service company for the oil and gas industry owned by her and her husband, Lyle. She also ran for school board in Lafayette Parish in 1979 while expecting her third child. All this at a time when women in business were still being encouraged to keep a low profile when expecting. We visited with Mrs. Mouton at her office in Broussard, where she told us that she originally intended her husband Lyle to represent their company at the Lafayette Chamber of Commerce.
I called the chamber and said, "We are interested in joining the chamber and my husband wants to be representative." Well, Lyle went ahead and joined as the representative, but he didn't become active. And our local chamber takes an active position on many, many issues that impacts the lives of all of us in Lafayette, not just the business community. And I took note of that, and with Lyle not being active, I said, somebody has to be active. We're paying the dues, and we need to take an active part. So I said, would you move over and allow me to be the representative and allow me to get involved? Because I am interested in education and some of the issues they're addressing. And he said, oh, certainly, you know, and so therefore I became the representative and immediately took an active position in the chamber, beginning in the education committee.
You were not only the first woman president of the Chamber of Commerce, but the first black woman to serve as president of the Lafayette Chamber of Commerce. How did that feel?
I was really elated to be given that honor. However, I knew that that was going to carry a big, big responsibility. I knew that in the past 50 years, this was after 50 years of existence of our local chamber, that I was being given the honor of serving as the president. And I knew that if people had not paid much attention to the president in the past, they were certainly going to pay attention out of curiosity in some cases, and in other cases, just to take note and see if, in fact, a woman and a black woman could take charge and lead such a prestigious organization. So I had quite a task ahead of me, and at some times it was a frightening task, but one which I gladly accepted. And I am delighted to say that I had full support of my board and the membership.
In spite of the fact that Mouton joined a predominantly white and male domain, she has no negative memories to report.
I had nothing but complete support. I sometimes wonder if maybe the year was such a chaotic year, and one of my goals was to keep everyone optimistic and positive in their thinking, and maybe that carried over to the people who I was involved with, because I honestly can say that everything was of a positive nature. I cannot think of one instant that I had any negatives to deal with.
Mouton, who had run for school board several years ago, felt that Lafayette's future lay in its commitment to young leadership and a diversified economy.
We instituted a program called Leadership Lafayette. Again, not a new program to and unique to Lafayette, because it's also being done in Baton Rouge and Shreveport. So we patterned our program after the successes of those programs, and I must say that we have a high caliber program, and there are several blacks who are a part of our program, and here's an opportunity to develop future leaders within our community. A very successful program, ongoing, and it'll carry over into other administrations. Economic development was certainly, and it continues to be a problem here in Lafayette. And our focus definitely was, and we want to see Lafayette continue as an oil and gas market. However, we do realize that our greatest problem is that we're not diversified. So we went on, I instituted a program to try and work toward stabilizing the industry. Boy, a monumental task that the Chamber of Commerce president is going to try to stabilize an industry when, many, many high-level executives or teaming up to try to stabilize the industry. What a monumental task it was for me to think that, you know, I could do that. However, we did make several trips to Washington, D.C., and we did visit with the Secretary of Interiors and try to convince him to come down and see what the plight of our industry is. And we did visit with major oil companies to ask them to remain here in Lafayette. So we did do that. We also went about trying to do some research to see how we could, in fact, diversify Lafayette's economy. And what we found was that we have an opportunity to do that through tourism and through pharmaceutical, through the pharmaceutical industry.
All of this in 1 year?
We had a good year. We really did have a good year.
Well, that's it for this week's show. Be sure to join us next week for a look at affirmative action. See you next week. Bye-bye.